thanks to the organizers. I'm having a really nice time here. And thanks particularly to Professor Ghorpade for inviting me. So as I said, in fact, not just said, I'm forced to speak a little slowly because I have somewhat less material to talk about. So the kind of questions which I will look at are the following. We will look at some what are called differential equations. On open sets in the plane, and the issue is what is the criterion to tell when the solutions to these differential equations are algebraic functions? Criterion to tell when the solutions are algebraic functions. I'll hopefully define these terms. So that's what I want to discuss. But in order to formulate this criterion, one has to know what is called the monodromy group of the differential equation. And in order to talk about monodromy, one has to know the concept of analytic continuation. So that's what I will start with. So, monodromy. So there is a large overlap with what Professor Srinivas talked about. So we will look at very special cases of what he has said. So we will use the theory of covering spaces a little bit to make sense of analytic continuation. But to define analytic continuation, one can start in more elementary terms. So that's what I will do. So our basic object is a connected open set. In C. So the picture is, I have this open set in C. It may have punctures or it may have holes and so on. So, but it's connected, it's path connected. Any point can be connected to any other point by a continuous or even differentiable path. It's equivalent. So what we will do is start with a point P, and we're going to fix a path. Path joining P to Q. So I'm going to fix a point P, and typically I'm going to vary the point Q, and I will have a path joining P to Q. And I want to understand what is meant by analytic continuation of a given function along this path. You start with a function which is analytic in a neighborhood of P, and what it means to say to analytically continue that function along this path, that's what I want to understand. So what it means is the following. So suppose F1 is a holomorphic function. Function delta naught is a disk centered at P. And delta naught lies entirely in U. Given a point P, there is a little disk around P which lies entirely in the open set. So I choose such a disk. And I start with an analytic function on this disk. An analytic function here means a convergent power series. These two are the same. So we could agree with this. So then this interval can be chopped up into little pieces. And in each of these intervals, I find points P2, P3, etc., till I hit this point P. And in each of these intervals, suppose there is a function which is analytic in this little disk, call this F2. And suppose there is an analytic function in this disk, call it F3, and so on, such that on the intersections they agree. Then the final function that we get will be called an analytic continuation of the starting function. So a path gamma is by definition a continuous map from here to here, such that gamma 0 equals P and gamma 1, it ends at Q. So we are going to divide this interval into smaller pieces. So call this I. I1 contained in I2. So this whole interval has been written as a union of smaller intervals, such that is an interval for all s less than or equal to r. So in other words, I have this interval I1, I have this interval I2. So I take the union, I get this interval, and then I have a smaller interval here which overlaps the earlier one. So I take this union, that is I1 union, I2 union, I3, and so on. So I have this increasing union of intervals. And also, suppose delta I is a disk in U such that delta I contains the image under gamma of this ith interval. So this is delta I. And suppose Fi from delta I to C is holomorphic, analytic. So suppose I am given, suppose I am given n holomorphic functions in little disk, such that on the intersections they agree. Such that Fi equals Fi plus 1 on delta I intersection delta I plus 1. Then the last function, then Fr is called the analytic continuation of F1 along the path . So I start with a function which is analytic. I try to find a function which is in a disk different from the old one, but on the intersection it coincides, and then I find another function F3 which is here, so that on the intersection it coincides, and so on. So if I find this chain, finally I end up with some function here, which will be called an analytic continuation of the original function. But suppose, for example, let me take a very easy example. Let's just take a function which is analytic, not in the little disk, but it's analytic everywhere in the complex plane, like z squared. So I have this function which is z squared in this disk. Then I try to find some other function which is analytic, such that on the intersection it coincides with z squared. But there is no other function. Once I have a analytic function which is specified on an open set, then it's specified completely. Yes, this is the principle of analytic continuation. So if I start with something which is analytic everywhere, and I try to analytically continue, I get back the old one. So if I take f1 equal to this, this implies so the kind of functions which you will analytically continue are typically integrals along paths of what are called holomorphic differentials. So that's the real example which you want to look at. So suppose this is holomorphic. I'm given a function which is analytic in the entire open set. So let me define f of z. It's not really correct, it depends on the path. So I'm given a path. So this F is not quite a correct terminology because it depends on the path, but I'm going to drop it. So it is integral from P to Q along the path gamma. F of Q. Now you will see that this function is actually analytic as a function of Q in a small disk around Q. So here is the picture. We have this point P, and I have this path gamma, goes to the point Q, and then suppose there is a disk around Q which lies in this open set, this disk. So if I have any other point Z, I will take this path and then continue down this path to Q, in remaining within the disk. So this function, P to Z, GT DT, is holomorphic in a neighborhood of Q. And it coincides with F of Q when Z equals Q. So in this sense, this is an analytic function. So it is the analytic continuation of functions like this. But actually, the reason I'm stressing that it depends on the path is that it's usually not a single-valued function. This is what is called a multi-valued function, or rather a function on a covering space, to which we'll come immediately. So let me first establish some properties of this analytic continuation before giving the example which I have in mind. So Srinivas already talked about homotopy classes of maps. So let us take again an open set and see. So I have a point P and a point Q, gamma, some holes here. So I have this path, and suppose I have some other path, call this gamma naught, and some other path gamma 1. We will say that these two paths are homotopic if there is a one parameter family of paths from P to Q which starts at gamma naught and end at gamma 1. Okay? So two paths. I to U, gamma 0, 0. Okay. A homotopic. If there exists a continuous function edge from I cross I, is this interval 0, 1. To U, such that if I write HST, this function, gamma S of T, then it has the same properties. Gamma S of 0, it starts at P, gamma S of 1 is Q, and H0 of T is gamma 0, H1T is the second path, gamma 1. So there is a sequence of paths from P to Q which continuously varies from gamma 0 to gamma 1, and such a thing is called a homotopy equivalence. So you can easily see that if gamma 0 is homotopy equivalent to gamma 1, then gamma 1 is homotopy equivalent to gamma 0. You just reverse the direction of homotopy. In other words, change the variable S to 1 minus S. Okay? And if I have this path gamma naught, which is homotopy equivalent to gamma 1, and then another path gamma 2, which is homotopy equivalent to gamma 1, then gamma naught is homotopy equivalent to gamma 2, because I first pass through this homotopy and pass through the second homotopy. Okay, so this gives an equivalence relation. Is an equivalence relation. Between the paths from P to Q. So to come back to our original question, we have this point P, I have a path gamma, and I go to the point Q, let's say gamma naught, and I have another path which is homotopy equivalent to P, and I analytically continue the starting function along the path gamma 1. So how do these two differ is the question. And the thing is, they don't differ. If I have two paths which are homotopy equivalent, then the analytic continuations coincide. I won't prove this because it's really more or less a general topology lemma. What you do is, suppose I have a path which is very close to gamma naught. I have this little disk where things pairwise coincided, and they continue to do so along the homotopy path. So the analytic continuation along gamma naught and along gamma s for s close to 0 will be the same. And I keep doing this till I hit gamma 1. Okay? So the so let me just write down the statement. The analytic continuation of a given F naught from a disk to C, disk inside U, to a point Q in C, Q in U, along a path gamma depends only on the homotopy class. Of gamma. I won't, by the way, all these things need formal proofs, but I'm just sort of sketching the proof. Because here, really, it is just proving the same thing for paths close to the original one, and then keep doing this. There is a kind of Lebesgue number lemma which is involved, into which we will not go. So let me instead take an example. So my open set is C star. So it's the complex plane which is punctured at the origin. -0. So my starting point is this point 1. And I can take a path in C star from P to some point Q. Let's call this Z now. Okay. So I'm going to look at one such example. So the integral along the path 1 to Z. So I'm going to take for this function g, the function g of t equals 1 by t. All right. So I get this function which is locally holomorphic in Z. But let us see if I change the path, what happens. So I can take two paths in C, in C star. One is the path which starts from 1 and ends back at 1, which goes around this so e to the 2 pi I t, that is my gamma t. So gamma of 0 is 1 and gamma of 1 is also 1. So it goes like this. And the other path, gamma 1 of t equals 1 for all t. Now what is this integral? Along the first path, if I go from this point 1 back to 1, integral 1 to 1, so to speak, dt of t is, this path integral is by definition the integral, I goofed up. I have written t for the variable in closed interval 0 1 and as well as this. Let me call this w. Integral 0 to 1, gamma prime t dt. Yeah. It's 2 pi I. Okay. But if I went around this path, I'm not doing anything, so its derivative is 0. So the integral among the path, integral of the path gamma, along the path gamma 2 is 0. So these two paths are not homotopic. The first path went around this point, and it's what's called the path with winding number 1. This other path was a constant path which had winding number 0. Therefore, you are getting 0 here. And here, you are getting 2 pi I times the winding number, which is 1. Path, but only on the homotopy class of maps in the path. So I'm not going to prove this, but the, I should have said something here. If I start with the path from P to P itself, Srinivas has already mentioned that. So suppose I take P equal to Q in U and homotopy classes of maps, from P to P are also loops based at P. With homotopy equivalence. This is called the fundamental group of the of the open set based at P. But it's in fact a group under composition of paths. If I start with a path, and if I start with another path, so I start with one and then compose it with the next one, follow it along the first path and then follow it along the second, I get a new path, which is called the product of these two. Okay, so under this composition, this actually becomes a group, and this is called the fundamental group. So the fundamental group of C star is actually generated by this path k times, and it is the fundamental group of C star is in fact Z. There is one more way to understand this situation, why this is 2 pi I. So let me just give this. As I said before, this function Z, the function, so back to C star. The function integral 1 to Z, dw over w, this is not really a function, right? Because we have seen that if I follow along one path, I get one answer. If I follow along another path, I get zero. So it's a multi-valued function. So it actually, we would like to think of it as an actual function somewhere else. So that somewhere else is in fact spanned by this. So we all know that this morally this should be log. The issue is what branch of the logarithm are we looking at? This is just the logarithm of Z. So if I view every function, every element of C star as exponential of something, so the map C to C star given by is in fact a covering map. And this function log is simply saying that given a W, we call this Z. Sorry, my notation is a bit bad. So A goes to this. So I'm choosing a value of A such that e to the power of A is Z. That's what this does. But there are many values of A such that e to the power of A is Z. So I could choose any one of these values. So these are called branches. So this A is not uniquely determined. Given Z, but so let's call this map phi. So phi inverse of A is is of the form A plus 2 pi I n, and in Z. So if I change A to A plus 2 pi I times an integer, this value does not change, and what we have is not a function which is holomorphic in Z, but in fact it is holomorphic in the variable A. So if I take this analytic continuation along any path, but substitute Z equals e to the power of A, then this is actually holomorphic in A. So analytic continuation of a given function simply means that you view it as a function on this bigger space, the covering space, and then it just becomes an honest analytic function everywhere in C. But there are instances where, you know, you are not given the covering space, you are just given the base. And that's when this becomes relevant. So let me just give you the example that we have in mind. Then you will see what is going on. So before giving that example, I have to quote a theorem in differential equations. So I have to first establish some connection with differential equations. And analytic continuity. So the kind of differential equations which you are going to look at are what are called linear differential equations. So the starting point for us will be a theorem of Cauchy, which we will state. So I am going to choose for my open set U the unit disk centered at 0. So it's the unit disk 0, disk of radius 1. So I am going to choose F0, F1, Fn minus 1 from the disk to see holomorphic function. So the differential equations that we want to look at have the following shape. So let me explain what I'm doing. I want a function y which is holomorphic, at least locally, so that if I differentiate this function n times and then do this, I should get 0. So if y is such a solution, let's say y1 is a solution, then a constant multiple of that y1 is also a solution because it's linear. And if y1 and y2 are solutions, y1 plus y2 is also a solution. Yes? So the solutions form a vector space, clearly. Solutions form a vector. Yeah? Fnz y equals 0. Oh, f0, f0, yeah, thanks. There is a y. There is a y. It's a linear differential equation. Yeah, n minus 1 thing indexed by n minus 1 derivative, thing indexed by n minus 2 derivative, 0 and. So the theorem of Cauchy says that you can always solve this, always, and you can find the basis of solutions which are holomorphic in the entire disk. There exists a basis of solutions holomorphic to start. You can always solve this. But we want to use this in order to talk about analytic continuation of solutions when the disk is replaced by some arbitrary open set. That's what we want to do. So So suppose U is now an open set, a connected open set. Okay, so we want to solve by the way whatever I am going to talk about for quite some time is in the last chapter of Alfors's book on complex analysis. He has all this with proofs. Maybe a word of how the proofs go. You see, these are convergent power series because they are holomorphic functions on the disk. So you want to solve the differential equation, which are also convergent power series. So write down the solution, write down the hypothetical solution like this. And plug it into this, you will get a series of linear equations. The k plus nth coefficient will depend linearly on the previous coefficients. And you solve this, you can formally solve this power series. But in fact, that power series converges because it has, you know, the solutions are arranged like this. So it's quite easy. The formal solution, you can see, actually converges in the entire disk. Okay, so that's the proof. Anyway, so to come back to this, so I start with a open set. Now it has some holes, some punctures and so on. That is the problematic case. The same equation. But what I do know is that if I am given a point P, there is a basis of solutions here. That's all I am given. I am not because of Cauchy's theorem. Cauchy's theorem says that there is a basis of solutions at a given point. And then I will take a path from P to Q. And then fix a point here and find a disk around that point. I can find a basis of solutions there, which even coincide with these, and so on. So I can analytically continue along this path. So I get a basis of solutions here at Q. Okay. So if I go along this and even come back to P, I will get some other basis of solutions. That solution may not be the old basis. Is this okay? See, this theorem of Cauchy says that given a disk, I can find solutions. And given a contiguous disk, I can find some other set of solutions such that they even agree on the intersection. So I can keep doing this and follow it along the path. When I come back to the point P, for example, there is no guarantee that that basis of solutions is the one that with which I started. Yeah? So if epsilon 1, epsilon n are a basis of solutions, to start at a disk around P, then analytic continuation loops in U based at P gives another basis of solutions. This one Maybe I should have mentioned this. See, I already have these functions fn minus 1, which are holomorphic everywhere in the open set. So when I analytically continue, they don't change. Under analytic continuation, global holomorphic functions don't change. So when I take these solutions, they will still be solutions of the same differential equation. The coefficients have not changed. Yeah? So I get another basis of solution. So give along loops gamma, let us say. So this delta I, the let's represent this basis by a column vector. This basis element is a matrix. Of the old basis element. And this matrix depends on the homotopy class of the path. So given gamma in pi 1 of u based at p, get a matrix rho gamma. Which is in GLNC. You see, this is given by a change of basis, therefore it's an invertible matrix. So given an element of the fundamental group, I'm getting a matrix here, which is invertible. And what's more, we have agreed that if I take a path, if I go around the path gamma 1, and then go around the path gamma 2, I will actually be going around the path gamma 1 composed with gamma 2, which is the product in the fundamental group. So when I use this composition, in other words, so rho of gamma 1, gamma 2 is rho gamma 1, rho gamma 2. So we get this. So it, in other words, we have a homomorphism. Thus, rho GLNC, sorry, pi 1 of u to GLNC is a group homomorphism. So whenever I have a group G and I am given a homomorphism into GLNC, that such a homomorphism is called a representation. So this representation is what's called the monodromy representation. And the image rho is called the monodromy group. So much for this general theory. Again, let me take a very special example so that we can at least compute the monodromy group. Suppose I want to know, let us say I have a nice open set in C, maybe U equals C star or something. And I'm assuming that, I'm going to assume that these FIs are all rational functions in Z. Okay. Suppose I assume this. Not rational even, yeah, rational functions in Z with no poles at Z equal to 0. So then the question I would like to ask is, when is the monodromy finite? Yeah, when is the monodromy finite? Which is the same thing as saying that the solutions are all algebraic. I hope to sketch a proof of this statement. So I want to understand, when are the solutions sets algebraic functions? By algebraic functions, I mean functions like root z, cube root of 1 plus square root of 1 plus z squared. We will make it precise in a minute. Things like this. So when can solutions be like this? it turns out that the solutions are algebraic in the sense if and only if the monodromy group is finite. So that would be the connection between algebraic functions and monodromy. And the monodromy group is in fact called the Galois group of the differential equation. So let me just take a very simple example. Again, I'm going to take my basic open set to be C star. So I fix some rational, some number, complex numbers. So this is my differential equation. So notice something about this. The solution, the coefficient, namely 1 by z, is holomorphic on C star. Yeah? It's a holomorphic function on C star. 1 by z is not holomorphic on C, it has a pole, but on C star it's okay. And the fact that it's not holomorphic on C is what gives us some monodromy actually. So it's good that it has a pole at z equal to 0, but z equal to 0 lies outside our set. So this is a good holomorphic function. So I'm not going to solve it formally. Of course, it can be solved here, sorry. dy by y. So in other words, log y is alpha log z, or y is z to the alpha. Okay. But this function, as you will notice, is not single valued. For example, I could have taken root z, alpha equals half. This is not a single valued function. So I should really think about it as a function on C, where C star is a quotient of C by the group e to the 2 pi I z. So y of tau is e to the 2 pi. Z is e to the tau. And that tau was, so to speak, log of z. So what happens to the monodromy? When I analytically continue such a function along a path based at 1, so I have this picture before, 1, 0. I have this path from 1 to 1. So when I analytically continue along this path, log z becomes log z plus 2 pi I. Correct? So this becomes, tau is log z. So y of tau gets sent to e to the alpha tau plus 2 pi I. So this is the same as the old one times the old solution times this. So the monodromy representation, which indeed should go into GL1C, should give me a complex number on the generator. Pi 1 of u is z. So this homomorphism is described completely on what happens to the generator 1. So the generator 1 goes to this complex number e to the 2 pi I alpha. GL1C, 1 goes to e to the 2 pi I alpha. So that is the monodromy representation. So now let us ask, when is this function algebraic? Suppose I want to know when is this function z to the alpha algebraic? So let's recall what is meant by an algebraic function. It should be an algebraic function in Z. Right? So functions like this, suppose y is such a function. Let's say y. Y cubed equals 1 plus square root 1 plus z squared. In other words, y cubed minus 1, the whole square, is 1 plus z squared. So there is a polynomial in y and z which is 0. So that is what is an algebraic function. An algebraic function is one of the form where P of phi z comma z equals 0 for some polynomial P in two variables. So if I have a polynomial in two variables which vanishes at phi z comma z, then we will say that phi of z is algebraic in z, like here. Y cubed minus 1 the whole squared is 1 plus z squared. So it's an algebraic function. So with this definition, we want to know when z to the alpha is an algebraic function.